This is the story of one of the most beautiful places on Earth, a place which is also keeper of some of the world's most deadly secrets. It's a place which was once, for many, an important source of local employment. And this is a story full of ghosts. Fifty-six years ago, Allied troops discovered the Nazi death camp at Auschwitz. This is where the Nazis used poison gas to murder more than a million Jews.
At the end of the Second World War, Britain discovered, to its horror, that the Nazis had developed a sort of super chemical weapon, which were the nerve gases. The British and other Allied intelligence officers went over to Germany and took what they wanted. The Germans were in no position to object because they were the vanquished nation, and British military scientists took data, equipment, reports, whatever they wanted.
Down in New Orleans where everything's fine, all them cats is drinking that wine.
These pictures of Nancekuke have never been seen on television before. Until tonight, they were classified under the Official Secrets Act. The huge factory complex between Porthtowan and Portreath made the most deadly chemicals known to science. But there was a problem. The Geneva Convention of 1925 outlawed chemical weapons. Secret government documents show civil servants knew Nancekuke was illegal under international law.
A real difficulty might arise if publicity is given to the building of nerve gas production plant. You know our position under the Geneva Convention.
The Foreign Secretary does not know of the Nancekuke project.
I think it was the 1st of December 1952 that I was invited to go to Nancekuke for an interview. You had a fitter's mate who worked with you, and he stood outside and fetched any tools you needed. And the air from inside all these cubicles was sucked out by a fan, and then it went eventually into the tall chimney and was blown out up about, oh, I don't know, 80, 100 feet high, this chimney. And the air and so on was blown out there.
Early in the morning, I'm giving you my morning, don't you step on my blue suede shoe.
I was employed here in 1953 by a company called Messrs. E. Thomas & Company. I was an apprentice with a civil engineering project here at Nancekuke on a shaft which was approximately 4 metres by 3 metres wide and 70 metres in depth, and then tunnelling out to the sea, for which we was told at the time was to be used for chemical waste from the nearby chemical plant which was being built at the same time.
Nancekuke's outfall pipe is still visible at low tides today.
The next action is to remove the eye shields and he drops them to the ground. Then he puts on the face piece, straightens it out by feeling all around the edge and makes sure that there are no twists. The next action is to fasten up the haversack, and there you see he has gained complete protection.
The minister agrees to tenant farmers who have occasion to work within the perimeter being issued with respirators when they are inside the perimeter. He is anxious that no impression should be given that we consider that there is any risk to civilians outside the perimeter.
Unknown to local residents, the sarin gas made at Nancekuke was transported by road through several West Country towns and villages. Its destination, the government's main centre for chemical and germ warfare, Horton Down in Wiltshire.
Good attention! Right hand! The both art!
Nancekuke's nerve gas was tested on animals and humans.
In addition to the effects already noted, the casualty suffers muscular twitching.
Thousands of servicemen volunteered, although it's still not clear if they knew the scientists were trying to find out how much gas was needed for a lethal dose. 20-year-old airman Ronald Madison died during one of these tests. When I die, well, when Cupid shot his dart, he shot it at your heart. Many of the volunteers now have problems with their eyes. Some can no longer breathe properly.
Now this man is showing essentially the mild effect.
There was a notice went round asking for volunteers to go to find a cure for common colds with an opportunity to earn a bit of money. First of all, I think it's a horrendous way to deal with people. But what I do think is that the research had to be conducted in order to be able to combat anything that anyone else did.
Prime Minister Winston Churchill was determined that Britain should have an independent supply of chemical weapons. Secret government documents show how Churchill ordered the construction of a second, much larger factory at Nancekuke to build massive quantities of nerve gas. But in 1955, Churchill suffered a serious stroke. He could no longer carry on as Prime Minister. In 1956, the government abandoned Churchill's plan for the mass production of nerve gas.
The blossom has constantly to be protected. Sprayed time and again with lime and sulfur solutions used in different strengths throughout the season.
The deadly history of Nancekuke began a new chapter when the government leased the factory to the private chemical company ICI to make a potent agricultural pesticide called Ameton. It was so dangerous that after a few years it had to be withdrawn. Nancekuke's scientists then helped develop a new chemical weapon, one so successful it's still in use today. CS gas. Secret documents prepared for Prime Minister Harold Wilson show how Britain sold CS gas all around the world. The customers included many countries with poor human rights records. The 1960s summer of love ended under a cloud of tear gas. Only a handful of people knew that this highly effective weapon was one of Cornwall's most lucrative exports. The manufacture of chemical weapons is inherently dangerous. Official records show nearly 100 accidents at Nancekuke. This photograph was taken nearly 40 years ago. Almost everyone shown here is now dead. Clifford Cook has severe breathing problems.
I was in the cube we were working. The tube that runs down from your respirator that caught on the edge of the tray as I bent down like that, and it lifted the mask up over my chin, you know, to my nose. Of course, the fumes was coming up pretty thick, like, you know, really, it was quite a reaction there. And I knew immediately that I had inhaled, you know, the fumes from the nerve gas.
In 1958, Tom Griffiths worked at Nancekuke as a toxic fitter.
As soon as I got level with the flanges to measure how much I had to alter the pipe, I saw this droplet of liquid on the bottom of the flanges, and I knew immediately it must be sarin. I looked down and there was a damp patch on the floor, and by this time I could hardly see, and I was coughing violently. So I shouted to the other chap to get out, and I jumped from the ladder because it wasn't all that high, and we came outside, but by this time, and we could hardly breathe, eyesight affected and chest pains.
It worried me, and I think probably it worried a lot of other people there. But of course we couldn't do much about it. Work was scarce and we had to accept it.
Some Nancekuke workers who were worried about their health say they were threatened with prosecution under the Official Secrets Act if they made public their concern. Silence is golden. of the most remarkable things about Nancekuke is how they managed to keep it so secret for so long. In the early 1950s, when the factory was built, society was generally more respectful of authority. But by the mid-1960s, people were starting to ask questions, and Nancekuke would not be able to hold on to its secrets much longer. Public reference to what was going on at Nancekuke came in 1965 in a small left-wing magazine called Peace News. Absolutely no one, except perhaps the security services, paid any attention at all. But 3 years later, the Campaign for Nuclear Disarmament repeated the allegations in its own magazine, and the secret of Nancekuke was out. Peace campaigners wanted to know more about what went on behind the wire. But the government insisted everything to do with Nancekuke should remain top secret to protect national security. Eventually, though, the protesters' campaign succeeded in forcing the release of some information.
Well, let's get this absolutely straight. The amount of nerve gas they make is absolutely tiny, and they only make it for preparation purposes so that Porton can experiment with it. In fact, the last time they ever transported any of this was back in last February, and it's very, very small quantities indeed. The security arrangements for transportation are incredibly good, and I was very impressed with these.
The protests continued. The government insisted the transport of gases by road was safe. But a draft, unpublished version of a government report obtained by this programme said concentrating all chemical weapons work at Porton Down would have posed unacceptable risks to the more heavily populated areas of Salisbury and Bournemouth. It also drew attention to the convenience of the Atlantic Ocean for the disposal of Nancekuke's waste. These details were edited out of the published report. In 1969, protesters blamed Nancekuke for the sudden, unexplained deaths of a large number of seals and seabirds.
I am utterly satisfied, and indeed so is the Ministry of Agriculture and Fisheries, because they have said so too. We are totally satisfied that the effluent from Nancekuke cannot be causing the seal trouble, nor indeed the dead birds, nor the dead fish. Whatever it is attributable to, it is not attributable to what the Ministry of Defence does at Nancekuke.
In private, ministers were concerned about the health of Nancekuke's workers. They commissioned research to find out the truth. The government insisted there was no evidence of anything to worry about. In fact, there was considerable evidence. Evidence which the government kept to itself.
Our top story. For 30 years, it's remained secret. But now West Country News can reveal the truth. People who worked at the government's former nerve gas factory at Nancekuke did suffer a higher than average degree of sickness and ill health.
14 months ago, I was granted privileged access to the government's files. Documents showed the government's own research had found Nancekuke workers were at least 30% more likely to suffer serious bronchial and respiratory illnesses. Civil servants had again edited out crucial details to mislead MPs. The discovery of these files prompted the first ever debate in Parliament about Nancekuke.
41 men died. 9 during employment and 32 after leaving the establishment between 1950 and 69. We learn more than was published before of just how these men died. Some complicated statistical analysis was applied and concluded that such a death rate was lower than the national average. I would say to my honourable friend that if a small company employing 150 people lost 41 current and former employees among a relatively young and healthy cohort, alarm bells would ring.
I think their attitude is disgraceful. I mean, they lost my blood cholinesterase records up there in the early days of the case, which would have proved undoubtedly whether there had been long-term effects. And by losing them, I would class that as criminal negligence.
So now they've got the facts out in the open, you know, I can talk about it. But before that, I couldn't. But I couldn't even tell my own doctor because I went up there and I had some chest problems. I went up to see him. And he said, he got quite mad, as a matter of fact. He said, I have to swear. I said, how can I treat you? He said, I don't know what you're working on. And he asked me two or three times, and I said, I'm sorry, I can't tell you. So, you know, it's very secretive, even then.
Well, from what I've seen of the evidence from Nancekuke, the authorities should have shared the information they collected. They would seem to have had clear evidence that bronchitis, both acute and chronic bronchitis, was much higher in the working population at Nancekuke. They were clearly trying to cover something up which they ought not to have done.
Is this the real life? Is this just fantasy? Caught in a landslide, no escape from reality. Open your eyes.
In 1975, the government announced Nancekuke was to close. Many of the workers would face unemployment. The last batch of nerve gas left Nancekuke in May 1977. And so begins the story of how Nancekuke was decommissioned. Mustard gas was incinerated, scrap metal once used in the manufacture of deadly sarin was buried in shallow graves. Sometimes it was simply dumped down old mine shafts. Remaining stocks of nerve gas were diluted and pumped out to sea. A Ministry of Defence inquiry to assess the possible contamination of the site has found traces of CS gas and high explosives, although there's no evidence of nerve gas contamination. The inquiry is due to report any day now.
The air attack warning sounds like this is the sound.
Over the past 30 years, the technology pioneered in Cornwall has spread around the world.
It's absolutely impossible to keep the genie in the bottle, and I think the genie has been out and moving around for years and years now. There was a treaty that was signed, came into force in 1997, and this requires countries which sign up to it to agree not to be involved in chemical warfare in any way. That's having stocks of the things, using it, and trading or selling chemicals to other countries who might want to make chemical warfare agents.
In 1979, shortly before handing Nancekuke back to the RAF for use as a radar station, the government invited more than 20 scientists and diplomats to visit the base as part of a United Nations disarmament mission. They could go anywhere, see anything, talk to anyone and gain as much information as they wanted. One of these scientists was Professor Vladimir Vojvodic, a chemical weapons expert from Yugoslavia. Twenty years after Professor Vojvodic visited Nancekuke, Britain and its NATO allies bombed what they claimed were chemical weapons factories in the former Yugoslavia. The damage and pollution caused by these bombing raids is still evident today. Professor Vojvodic is no ordinary academic. He was also a Lieutenant General in the Yugoslav National Army. Now retired from military life, he still lives in Belgrade. This is the first time he's been interviewed for British television.
In my
I remember when I was in Geneva very often for the meeting, chemical disarmament meeting, we divide the chemical warfare engines in two categories. One was really pure from point of view of the military one. Second one is dual purpose agents. That means could be used in peaceful industry.
Well, you can find the ingredients for making chemical agents, and you can find this information in a variety of places. So it isn't hugely difficult, but you have to make sure when you're making these things that you've got very sophisticated protection to ensure that your own staff don't get exposed. And it's not as easy as people imagine to spread the agents around.
Lieutenant General Vojvodich confirms the 1979 UN tour of Nancekuke contributed to the construction of chemical factories bombed by NATO.
When we came to the United Kingdom, first we visited some military installations on the east part of England. After that we visited many chemical factories, what was really very, very useful for us. We saw activities and efforts in that places very much concerned with the protection of human beings. What was great experience for us, how someone could manage protection in chemical factories.
For several months, we've been pressing the Ministry of Defence for an interview to respond to the issues raised in this programme. The government continues to deny responsibility for the illnesses suffered by the former Nancekuke workers, and it says there are no outstanding environmental problems. But no minister has been prepared to take part in this programme. Perhaps the most intriguing question about Nancekuke is why, even today, around a dozen of the government's archive records are still classified. Is this to protect national security or to prevent political embarrassment? Well, who can say? It's an official secret.